Hi, and welcome to Tiger Art. Today, we're going to be talking about one of the most brilliant and influential artists of all time. His name was Pablo Picasso. Pablo Picasso was a Spanish artist, and as a young child, he would be what we would call a prodigy. Now, a prodigy is somebody who's amazingly good at something from a very young age. So when he was your age, he was painting just as good and better than I can, which I've spent my entire life learning how to paint. Pablo Picasso, as a child, was unbelievably good. Let's look at some pictures and see what we can know about Picasso in the abstract movement. Look at these two pictures. They look pretty realistic. One is the Mona Lisa, which is a very famous painting. You've probably seen it before, you've heard of it. Everybody knows what the Mona Lisa is. The other one is by an artist named Ang, and he was a French artist who was also very skilled at realism. So on one side we have Mona Lisa, who was made by Leonardo da Vinci, and that looks very realistic, very believable. This is traditional art. And on the other hand, we have like the quintessential, the perfect realist painter, Ang, and it looks so real that we can't even tell it's a painting a lot of the times. This is what art was for many, 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 many years. Throughout history, all the way up until about maybe 100 something years ago, this is what we saw. We saw artists that paint things that look real. And the reason why is because there were no cameras. So if you wanted to have a picture of yourself or someone else, you would have to pay an artist to make that picture. So you didn't have all these pictures around your house of family members and stuff to remember them. So if you were gonna pay somebody, you would only wanna pay people that could make it look exactly like the person or exactly like the thing that you wanted the picture of. There wouldn't be much value in somebody who makes something that doesn't look like that person. So artists that couldn't do that were thought to be bad. Or if you painted something that doesn't look exactly like real life, it was because you couldn't or because you were bad. So Pablo Picasso comes along. He notices that, hey, there's a camera now and a camera can do this better than we can. It can take pictures perfectly fine. Looking ahead in the future, you may see pictures all over the place that anybody can make with their own camera. So I need to find a way to make myself more valuable. That's what Picasso did. He helped create what we call the abstract movement. So imagine you're in a gallery in like the early 1900s, and everything you've ever seen all looks like the Mona Lisa or something very real. Pablo Picasso rolls in with this, his self-portrait. And you think, sir, I think you're in the wrong place. This is an art gallery. That does not look very good. They didn't know what to think of it. They were confused. But then maybe they saw some of his younger stuff and realized this guy really knows how to paint realism. He could do it when he was young, but he got bored with it. So then he starts doing this. Either he's lost his mind or he's smarter than I am and smarter than I think he is. Look at it for a second though. I've taught you how to draw things using basic shapes and kind of building things out of shapes from the inside out. He's doing that here. He just isn't erasing the shapes then and making it look real later. He's actually emphasizing those shapes and making it a design of interesting shapes. Look at all the triangles in this picture. Look at the way all the triangles kind of fit together like pieces of a puzzle. That's pretty cool. That's unique. That's original. And it's creative. That's Picasso. This is an example of one of his paintings from when he was younger. So you can see that he really knew what he was doing with realism. He knows how to make light and depth and believable, you know, lifelike figures. That's not easy to do. This is really advanced stuff that he was doing earlier in life. Take a look at this picture. I like this one a lot because it reminds me of Spain, and I love the country of Spain. palm trees. We got like the beach, the water out there, and you know, like these beach houses. Kind of looks like they're origami almost. They're like folded pieces of paper, it looks like, because he's focusing so much on these abstract shapes. So you take something, you abstract it, which means you take away the details and you look at just the shapes, and then you don't put the details in, you actually emphasize those shapes and make them even more angular and exaggerated. Here's another painting of a studio. So we can see it looks like an art studio. We got like a chair, we got an easel with a painting, we got a model of a head, a stool, but it's abstracted. It's not as real as, you know, you would think. It doesn't have all the details. When you're not working in realism and trying to make everything look like the real world, you can get pretty strange with it. This picture looks kind of crazy, but that's okay because Picasso is making everything kind of strange. This is a very famous Picasso painting called The Three Musicians. And the musicians in here are built out of shapes. So it's very abstract. We can't really tell what they are immediately, but if we look at it, we can find clues. Like we can find a part of a guitar, or we can find some music notes, and we can see kind of like a clarinet that somebody's playing. So it looks like three musicians, but not really. It's pretty abstract. Well, let's get rid of everything and see if we can figure out an abstract painting. What's going on here? I hear all kinds of stuff when I show this to students. They think it's an Egyptian tomb, they think it's a city, they think it's broken glass. They say all kinds of strange stuff, very creative ideas. But in reality, we can pick out that it's a man playing a guitar. You can see kind of where his head is and his shoulders, and you can see his arm kind of bent like this, and you can see some guitar strings here. And it kind of looks like he's moving like this as he's playing the guitar, because you see multiple lines for each thing. But when you look at it, it's more interesting to not know what it is. What happens here when you have abstract art is that one person looks at it and sees one thing. Somebody else sees another thing. Somebody else sees something totally different. Nobody's really right and nobody's really wrong in this picture, because if you can explain why you think it's that, that's good enough. So what happens is it's like a puzzle, and people love to solve puzzles. So when they look at it, they can't figure out what it is, and it makes them want to look more. So you start looking for clues. That causes you to look longer at the picture. Then you start talking to somebody else, and if they say something you don't agree with, it makes you even more interested, and you think, no, that's not right. Look, this is the head here. Well, it doesn't really look like a head, so somebody else might see the head somewhere else, and that's okay. If you all look at a picture that looks exactly like real life, immediately, you all know what it is, and there's nothing to disagree about, there's nothing to argue about, so you don't talk about it, you don't look at it. But the more people start to talk about this and look at it, some people are gonna like it, some people aren't. But really, it's about starting the conversation, and that's abstract art is really good at that. Here's another Picasso painting of some guitars and stuff in a room, and it looks kind of like a hidden face. Picasso didn't make this up all on his own. He had some friends. He had other people that were making abstract art a little bit before him, but not quite to the level of abstract that he was. There's another guy named George Braque. Pictured here, he and Picasso on the left, Braque on the right, they created a lot of paintings and collages that look similar to each other. So by kind of cutting up magazines or newspapers and, you know, gluing them together and building these abstract pictures, they made a lot of things that look a lot alike. Let's look at some of their pictures here. They look a lot like a lot of Picasso paintings I've seen too. Very abstract, very geometric looking shapes. Picasso did many other types of pictures that don't look as much like Braque, but these ones all kind of look similar. These are paintings by an artist named Juan Gris. He also made pictures that look a lot like the Braque and Picasso. So there's this artist named Salvador Dalí. He's a Spanish painter that you may also be learning about. Dalí was making surrealism and he wanted to do some abstract work as well. So he brings in some influence from Picasso. And this picture looks a lot like it could be made by Picasso, but it's in fact made by Dalí. This one is also made by Dalí. It has a very real kind of finish to it, but you know, it's cut up into shapes, looks kind of like a quilt of different pieces. And each piece kind of is an abstracted version of a part of something, and it's like this big tiger or a lion. I'm not sure which one. So the next few paintings you're gonna see are made by an artist named Juan Miro. He's another Spanish painter, and his are very unique too. So when you see these, you won't forget them. You'll remember what they look like because they're so unique. The style is distinct. This is one of my favorite paintings of all time. Why? I don't know. It's just too strange. You won't forget looking at it because I've never really figured out exactly what's going on here. It could be a ladder, it could be a moon, but it just, it's too strange. There's not that much going on here, but it's just bizarre. I like pictures like that because it's not like anything I've ever seen before, and it's memorable. So I want to show you some examples of other artists that are working more recently that were inspired by Picasso. This is by an artist named Romero Brito, which you will also learn about if you take my art class. Romero Brito is a pop artist living in Miami, Florida. He's originally from Brazil, but you can see a lot of the abstract shapes that he puts into his drawings are a lot like some of those Picasso ones. He also likes to use a lot of bright color and patterns. All right, so I'm giving you some things to start out with this project. We're making an abstract portrait. And that's important to know. A portrait is a picture of a person. So it shouldn't be a monster, it shouldn't be a room, it shouldn't be like anything you've seen before. It's a picture of a person, but it's abstract. So it could be you, could be somebody else, doesn't matter. I'm giving you some things to start this, like a piece of what we call chipboard. It's kind of like cardboard, but it's just really thin. But it's much thicker than paper, so when you're gluing things onto it, it will stand up pretty well. I'm also giving you some assorted colors of paper that look like they would belong in a Picasso or Braque abstract portrait. So they're all kind of muted colors like grays and browns and maybe some light blues and stuff like that, but a lot of very pale, not very vibrant colors. Our goal is to make something that looks kind of like this. I mean, this is one example that I made, and it's an abstract portrait, so it's nothing that I've seen before. I kind of just made it up all on my own. Now, the way that I did this was I didn't start by making it look like a person. I had no idea what it was going to look exactly like when I started. So the best way to do this is to take some of the pieces of paper that I've given you and just cut them into shapes. Don't cut like anything straight or regular, because that's totally against what we're trying to do here. We're trying to make it weird or strange, unusual. So what you should do is try cutting on an angle here and cut straight lines. That's what a Picasso looks like, is it's got a lot of straight lines and sharp angles. So cutting in straight lines, I'm just trying to make some various shapes. I don't even need to really pay too much attention, because I'm not gonna use every one of these. You don't want any shapes that are too big, and you probably don't wanna be working in shapes that are too small. So I'm just making a few shapes here. I don't know if I will use them or not. I do kinda like the way this looks. So the in-between shape looked pretty cool. So I have all this paper left. I can cut more if I need to, but the idea is just to cut randomly in different directions to try to make kind of angular looking shapes or triangular shapes. It may take you a little bit of practice to get things that look cool. You want unusual shapes. This shape has many different sides. It has no regular angles or anything. It looks quite unique. Excellent, that's exactly what I wanted. Let me just tell you something as a tip. The darker the color, the smaller the shape. If you take this and you glue a shape onto your picture that's this dark and that big, all of the attention goes to that shape. That is not what we want for the overall. So just beware of that. And the darker the color, the smaller the shapes should be. So if you're gonna use black, which you could, I wouldn't start with it, I would use it last, and I would make my shapes good and small. Same thing with white. If it's really bright, smaller shapes would be better. You could save white for later. Okay, so once you have an assortment of shapes and colors, you want to start with the biggest shapes you got. So if you got something big, that would be where you start. A portrait goes up and down, not side to side. So your page should be going this way. You will need some glue. This kind of glue works good. You could try using a glue stick, but I don't think it's going to work very well. So just, you know, if you have decent glue, just normal glue, I would suggest using that. Your goal for today is to just start gluing some shapes down and not throw anything away. If you can do that, this would be a success. So I'm going to find a shape. I'm going to glue it somewhere, starting with the bigger shapes that I got. You can and should overlap these shapes when possible because it makes new shapes. Push them down good. I would hold it like this and count to maybe 20 to make sure they stay down. Okay, that's about a good place to stop for today. Just stop when you got about half of it covered. Take a picture of it and submit.